So friends, we're going to pick up again in our Bible study in the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew chapter 8. If you turn your Bibles there with me, please, Matthew chapter 8, verse 1 is where we're going to start reading here in just a couple of minutes. If you don't have a Bible with you, feel free to use the one in the chair in front of you that's yours to use today. And as you turn there, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I am astonished how you have orchestrated this service. You have brought us together again today as your family, your body, your servants, your people. And Father, I ask that as we open your word, that our hearts, our eyes, our lives would be open to the presence of God, the work of the Holy Spirit here today, that we would see again Jesus Christ and who he is. Father, we get to throw aside all of the distractions this morning and focus in entirely on our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you for that. And Father, because of it, have your way in the lives of your children today. In your wonderful name we pray. Amen. Matthew chapter 8, verse 1. As we open up Matthew chapter 8, we actually come to a section change inside of the Gospel of Matthew. Many of you have been with us as we've gone through our series within a series. We slowed down. We paid attention to the Sermon on the Mount. Now that is done. We start a brand new chapter and the tone changes and we move from a large section of concentrated teaching to a series of stories, and specifically for us today, some healing stories. Inside of the Gospel of Matthew, he tends to organize his material around these sections of teachings of Jesus Christ. And there's five of those inside of the gospel, and we're just in between a couple of them as we open Matthew chapter 8. So here now we move to our string of stories, and we get to read about several things. Now, the stories that we read today primarily are stories about healings. Christ is going to encounter some fascinating people, have some incredible conversations, and then some amazing, miraculous things will happen as people are healed because of the touch and the care and the love of Jesus Christ. But I think we will also quickly discover that these teachings are not just about the healings themselves. They turn out to be about the people involved, who Jesus heals, how he interacts with them, how they approach him, how they respond to what Christ does when he produces physical healing inside of their lives. So we're learning a lot about these individuals and their interaction with Christ because of who he is and what he does for them. And then friends, ultimately, as we go through these beautiful healing stories, we're obviously learning a lot about Jesus Christ himself. So now at the Sermon on the Mount, at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, we read where the crowd was astonished at the authority of the teaching of Jesus Christ. Right at the end of Matthew chapter 7, verses 28 and 29, it says this, "And when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes." They were used to teaching on the law. They were used to teaching on the character and nature of God and what life was supposed to be like, but they weren't used to this. They weren't used to what Jesus had to say about life inside of the kingdom of God. There was something powerful to them about it. There was something deeply compelling to them about everything that Jesus teaches in the Sermon on the Mount. So they're astonished at his authority. And what happens as we walk through these first few stories of Matthew chapter 8 is we continue with the theme of authority. But now Jesus' authority takes on a different kind of shape. It is broadened and expanded for us. And so we get to play with the question through this passage of Scripture. What is Jesus' authority really like? What kind of authority does Jesus have? And as is always the case in the Gospel of Matthew, we are always working toward this answer, who is this Jesus really? In every step of the way, his character and divine nature is being opened to us. So this morning we have three scenes in particular that we're going to read. Jesus and a leper, Jesus and a centurion, and then Jesus, Peter's mother-in-law, and a crowd of people who experienced the power and the healing and the authority of Jesus Christ. So let's begin reading in Matthew chapter 8, starting in verse 1. When he came down from the mountain, great crowds followed him. And behold, a leper came to him and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, if you will, you can make me clean." Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him, saying, "I will, be clean." And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, "See that you say nothing to anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a proof to them." When Jesus comes down from the mountain, there is still a great crowd that is around him. This takes us back to the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. There at the start of Matthew chapter 5, it says that Jesus went up on the side of a mountain and a great crowd had gathered around him, and he begins to teach. And then we get those three chapters, 5, 6, and 7. The teaching is over. Jesus comes down the mountain, but this large crowd continues to follow him, astonished at his teaching. This happens often in the life of Christ. Because of the amazing things that people see or hear from him, for a period of time, a great crowd begins to follow Jesus Christ. So imagine, if you will, Christ at the bottom of this mountain, there near the shore of the Sea of Galilee, and a mass of people around him, his disciples near him. And then Matthew tells us, while this crowd of people was pressing around him, this leper cuts through the crowd and finds Jesus and begins to talk to him. So the crowd is large, but suddenly our focus is intimate. This one single individual finds Jesus Christ, and Matthew tells us that he is a leper. To understand what's going on in this conversation and this healing, we need to understand just a little bit about what it means that a leper has found Jesus there in the Sea of Galilee amidst a crowd of other people. To be a leper is a unique category of being sick in Scripture. There's actually a lot of Old Testament law about what it is and how to be treated while you are sick with some form of skin disease, how you are cleansed and how you are separated from your community, how you're brought back into your community. It's a unique form of being sick inside of Jewish culture. In both the Old Testament and New Testament, when the word leprosy is used, it's generally used to describe a range of skin diseases, including what we today actually call leprosy, but some form of disease that makes itself present on the skin. More often than not, it is something that is actually contagious. And so if you had it, you were separated from everybody else. You were not allowed to join into normal life inside of your normal home with your normal work, with your normal circle of people and your friends and your community. You were separated from your community while you had this disease until this disease then was cleansed or healed or had left you. So when this man actually makes his way into a crowd and finds Jesus, he's doing something that inside of his culture is actually forbidden for him to do. But he's hearing these stories about Christ. He has probably sat on this hillside and listened to this teaching. And here now he knows he has to get face to face with Jesus Christ. So he makes the effort to do something that normally in his world is forbidden. Now, if you are a leper, because of the uncleanliness of what you have, you're determined in their culture to be unclean. And if someone who does not have a disease like that actually touches you, they become unclean. And in order for them to re-enter society, they have to go and through their ritual purification process to become clean and allowed back inside of their normal culture. Now, on top of that, leprosy inside of this culture becomes what one New Testament scholar called a living parable of sin. It becomes this walking and talking, breathing, physical example of the corruption of sin that is inside of each and every one of us and how it makes us unclean. The disease itself and the person who carries the disease becomes a regular reminder of sin itself. So this guy has a lot going against him. Can you imagine being the person in your town who is a living, breathing reminder of all of our sin? That's the kind of life that this guy was leading for at least a period of time. Maybe even physically untouched by family and friends for a very long time. Separated from his community, and he's making his way now to a Jewish teacher, a man who might actually be considered a rabbi. Now, the normal response of a rabbi would be, don't come any closer. I'm not here to become unclean. You have to return from whence you came. So there's a lot on this guy. He has a lot going against him, but he approaches Jesus anyway. And when he does, what he says is so simple, but it is so powerful. It is so beautiful. Lord, if you will, you can make me clean. I know that if you want to, I will be made clean. He begins by calling Christ Lord. Keep an eye on that through this passage and really through the rest of Matthew's gospel. Jesus is addressed this way often, and this really is a word in the Greek in this context that can refer to the Lord himself attributing divine authority to an individual, but it can also mean someone who simply has a form of social authority or rank, maybe a member of royalty or a special teacher. But nonetheless, notice that the leper recognizes Jesus has a certain kind of authority. Lord, if you will, I can be made clean. And he knows that if Jesus wants to do it, Jesus can remove the leprosy from him. And notice the vocabulary that Matthew uses and that the leper uses in this conversation. We are talking about a physical healing of a disease, but the leper does not use the word for healing. The leper uses the word for to be made clean. If you want to, I know you can clean me. Isn't that incredible? From a marginalized and physically weak and ostracized man, we get this clear expression of faith. We see effort to make it to Jesus, and we see belief in what Jesus can do for him. Now, we need to be amazed by something like this, because sometimes I think a story like this that sometimes goes by so quick for us is supposed to prick something inside of us. And we're supposed to notice the kind of effort this man takes to get to Jesus. We're supposed to notice the kind of faith that he has in Jesus, as simple and straightforward as it is, and ask questions like, have I made this kind of effort? Do I have this kind of trust and belief and faith in Jesus Christ? The leper has it. Do I? Then the text says, Jesus stretches out his hand and touched him, saying, I will be clean. And immediately the leprosy was cleansed. When Jesus stretches out his hand and touches this man, at least two incredible things happen. And the first is pretty obvious to us. The first is pretty clear. The man is healed. He's physically healed. Whatever biologically has gone wrong with him, whatever the disease is, immediately leaves the man. Whatever lesions he had on his skin are immediately gone. And we recognize that Christ has authority over a deeply seated and rooted disease that they did not know what to do with. But Jesus has authority over that kind of thing and heals the man. But Jesus says, I will be clean. When Jesus cleans him of his leprosy, Jesus is actually giving him everything back. He's actually giving him his life back. A life that had become strained and separated from everything that was normal and lovely to him because of this disease. He not only heals it, he cleans him. And he gives him back his normal life. Isn't that incredible? And Jesus touches him. Under Old Testament law and custom, you were not allowed to touch a leper. It made you unclean. And we wonder, how long has this man gone without the physical touch of another human being? And when Jesus touches him, Jesus breaks the standard. He breaks the expected. And he lets this man feel both divine touch and divine love. And guys, this is beautiful. Instead of Jesus becoming unclean, the leper becomes clean. Isn't that beautiful? What does Jesus have the authority to do? He has authority to say to that leprosy, be gone, and it's gone. Jesus has the authority to restore to that man everything that he had lost. Every time there's a story in the Gospels where there's an interaction between Christ and the leper, I believe that you and I are put in two places inside of that story. In the first place, the first sort of thing that we have to wrestle with goes a little bit like this. Who am I willing or not willing to touch? Culture constantly creates these arbitrary and often wicked boundaries around human beings because of their station in life, their job, their background, their skin color, their language. Culture is constantly involved in this sort of identity society and identity politics that puts people in little buckets and says, treat them like this, treat them like this, treat them like this. And here comes Jesus plowing through every single one of those, and he touches the untouchable. Who am I ready to touch as a follower of Jesus Christ? How should I treat my fellow human being? Not because of what anything or anybody around me in this world says, but because I belong to a man who touches lepers. Because I belong to Jesus Christ. Who am I willing to touch? The second part of the story is, I think, the position of the leper. When Jesus touches a life, it becomes clean. We come to Christ, and in fact, I believe the Holy Spirit was speaking this morning through our worship and the things that were said. Friends, when we come to Christ with whatever set of burdens, with whatever set of past issues we come with, whatever kinds of sin or brokenness we come to with Jesus Christ, when He touches us, He does not become unclean, we become clean. And we are given the life that Christ wants to give us. Friends, do not believe that you carry with you an incurable uncleanliness. Because we come to the cross of Jesus Christ. We come to a man who touches lepers. We come to a man who restores lives that have been broken and lost. We come to a man who makes the unclean clean. Isn't that beautiful? And as Jesus puts it to this man, he actually even takes it one step further. He says, now go, I don't want any of this told at this point, but show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a proof to them. Jesus actually uses their Old Testament law to reveal who he is. I am the Messiah, the one who heals of this kind of disease. And the act of going to the priest and showing yourself clean is what gives him the official stamp on the official piece of paper that says, yeah, you can rejoin society. Isn't that beautiful? God, Christ, gives him his life back. Well, the stories continue here in verse 5. When he entered Capernaum, a centurion came forward to him, appealing to him, Lord, my servant is lying paralyzed at home, suffering terribly. And he said to him, I will come and heal him. But the centurion replied, Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I too am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. And I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he marveled and said to those who followed him, truly I tell you, with no one in Israel have I found such faith. I tell you, many will come from the east and the west and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the sons of the kingdom will be thrown into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And the centurion said to Jesus, and to the centurion Jesus said, "Go, let it be done for you as you have believed." And the servant was healed at that very moment. Jesus enters what in the region of Galilee is one of the major towns there along the shore of that little sea. He enters the city of Capernaum, and it's a major cultural and place of cultural center and place of commerce for both Jew and non-Jew, Jew and Gentile cultures alike. And while he is there, he's approached by a centurion, a man inside of the Roman army. And as a centurion, that means that he's a man of a fair amount of authority and probably even a fair amount of wealth inside of the region simply because of the position that he had in the occupying army. Now, beyond that, he turns out to be a rather unique man. We would call him in the New Testament a God-fearer. And a God-fearer is a Gentile who worships the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob as well as he knows. So this is a unique man. Yes, he is a centurion in the Roman army, but he is also one who honors and loves God and sees something inside of Christ. And notice again that he addresses him as Lord. The centurion says, "Lord, I have a servant," probably someone important and precious to him. "I have a servant who is sick, needs to be healed." And Jesus, like it's absolutely nothing. And to you and me, this is just an interesting conversational detail. To those around Jesus, this was a shocking thing to say. "Lord, I have a servant who is sick." And Jesus says, "Okay, I'll come over." You shouldn't do that. If you are a good Jew, according to the custom and traditions inside of that world, especially if you are a teacher of the law, you're not allowed inside of the house of a Gentile. Jesus is doing some interesting things. You're not supposed to touch a leper. He touches a leper. You're not supposed to walk into the house of a Gentile, much less a colonel in the opposition army. He says, "Well, I'm going to go. I'm going to walk into that house." If he walks into that house, that ritually makes him unclean. But we now know what happens when Jesus meets uncleanliness, right? We know this works in another way because of who Jesus is. Well, the centurion, maybe having some of this in his head, but then also recognizing who Jesus is, he says, "Lord, I'm not worthy to have you under my roof." The centurion actually says something incredible. And actually, according to Christ, it's the most incredible thing that happens in this story. He says something amazing. He says, "Jesus, you don't even need to be there. I know how authority works. Just say the word, and I know it will be done." So this guy has and lives in a culture of strict and severe military authority and order. He has those who are above him, and when a command is given, he does it. He has men beneath him as his soldiers, and when he gives a command, they do it. This authority structure inside of the Roman army is so complete and so total. Some really interesting things come to the surface. As I was going through this, I ran across something I had never seen before. Well, the Roman army has this order called the Order of Decimation. Now, the question is this. If you have a large number of your soldiers who have disobeyed orders or done something treasonous, how do you discipline a large number of soldiers without just killing all of them? Well, the Romans' rather unique answer to that form of discipline was called the Order of Decimation. As a centurion, this man is over 60 to 80 soldiers plus support staff, roughly 100 men. Let's say 50 of those men disobey orders and do something treasonous. Well, how do you affect discipline on a large number of your own soldiers? Well, this is how you do it. The centurion would have the right to separate a tenth of that group. 50 of them do that. He casts lots, randomly takes 5 of those men, and then gives 1 of 2 orders. The first order that he could give was, "In front of everybody else, everyone fall on your swords." And 5 of them would fall on their swords and commit suicide. The other order that this man could actually give was, to the other 45, beat those 5 guys to death. And when that is over, it's a, "Now look what happens to you next time" kind of story. That's authority. He says, "I know what authority is like. Then he turns to Jesus. And he says, all you have to do is give the word, and it will be done. He believes that Jesus has that kind of authority, not over soldiers who are bound to him, but Jesus has that kind of authority over the spiritual realm. Jesus has that kind of authority over healing in the physical body. This centurion, of all people, he sees into the authority of Jesus Christ in a way that very few do. Actually, the leper saw it. If you want to, I know you can make me clean. The centurion sees it. You don't even have to be there. Just give the word, and I know it will be done. And then Jesus responds to this in such an amazing way. Truly, I tell you, with no one in Israel have I found such faith. We read through the end of the story and we realize that the servant is healed. The servant is healed at a distance. The servant is healed instantaneously. And that is in and of itself a powerful and amazing thing that only Jesus can do. But what he sees as most amazing is the kind of faith that this centurion has in him and in his authority. It's the most incredible thing that Jesus sees here. And he says, I haven't seen this kind of faith. I haven't seen this kind of trust in all of the people of God up to this point. And faith, again, is a word that oftentimes we use so much that we lose track of its force and what it means, and it becomes a little fuzzy around the edges, or it turns into a certain kind of feeling that maybe we think we're supposed to have. It just means trust or confidence in. This man has a unique kind of trust in my authority and power, and I just haven't seen it in anybody else up to this point. So this centurion has a straightforward, clear faith in Christ. Faith in what Jesus can do for him. And Jesus uses this moment in this really interesting way. He uses this moment to talk about the ethnic reach of the kingdom of God. And he uses this moment to say, look, friends, see, the kingdom of heaven belongs to everybody. There's going to be a table that is set, and we will come and we will feast as the sons of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. He says, but there will be those who are sons of the kingdom. It's an interesting phrase for him to use, but by that he means those who are genetically descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who believe that the structure of their DNA and who they are and the way they dress and the way that they eat is actually what gives them admission to that table into the kingdom of heaven. And Christ says there will be those who will be surprised when they show up and they're not actually at the table. So when he does that, what Jesus says is this: the bar of entry to that feast around that table in the kingdom of heaven is belief in Jesus Christ. Jesus teaches, or he uses this moment to stress the importance of belief in him. Not just awe at his authority and power and the wonders that he works, but belief in him. So as we walk through these stories, we see clearly that Jesus heals. We see that Jesus makes the unclean clean. He gives back what was lost, both through illness and through sin. And we see that faith in Jesus Christ is the bottom line of my life. Is my trust in him and in him alone. So Jesus has this authority over sickness and sin. And the truth about who Jesus really is really matters. Friends, I think this raises an important point that shows up throughout the Gospels in a really interesting way, I think. Christ's power and Christ's lifestyle are never separated from the truth about who he really is. Christ has just got done teaching about life in the kingdom of God and what it is like with him now. And we see authority in that teaching. And then he begins to walk through this region and these miraculous things happen. And we see his authority over these kinds of things as well. We can't separate those two things. Before the Sermon on the Mount, at the end of Matthew chapter 4, it says that Jesus went throughout the region of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and healing many of sickness and disease. The miraculous power of Christ and his healing power is never disconnected from his teaching about who he is and the truth about who God is. That's important because I think often what we end up seeking or what people end up seeking is the miraculous gift given to us without belief in the truth of who Jesus is. We want miraculous things given to us or done. Maybe we're not ready to accept who Jesus truly is, the authority of his teaching as well. This shows up in another interesting way. We might want compassion shown, divorced from the truth of Jesus Christ. Christ doesn't do that. The touching of the leper, who am I ready to touch? This all sits in the context. It sits upon the foundation of the truth of who Jesus is. Jesus never separates his teaching from these miraculous and compassionate things, and we're not allowed to separate them either. As we walk into this world, we walk as ambassadors of Jesus Christ, his miraculous power, his compassionate touch, in the truth of the saving power of Jesus Christ. That's the package we walk into this world with. Christ never separates those things, and we are not allowed to either. There's one more story in this train. Matthew chapter 8, verse 14. And when Jesus entered Peter's house, he saw his mother-in-law lying sick with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she rose and began to serve him. That evening they brought to him many who were oppressed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with the word and healed all who were sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. He took our illnesses and bore our diseases. Not far from the synagogue in Capernaum, and you can go and visit the archaeological site today, is a house where many believe to be actually Simon Peter's house and where his mother-in-law was healed. It's not that far from the synagogue there inside of that city. But Matthew tells us he enters Peter's house and his mother-in-law has come ill with a fever. Now, as far as scholars tend to believe, this is more than just her fever's hit about 101 and she's kind of uncomfortable. There along the shores of Galilee, she might have something a little bit like malaria. This could be a very serious thing, again, for her life. So when Jesus touches her and heals her, again, this is a life-giving thing that Jesus does for Peter's mother-in-law. And then something so beautiful and yet so simple happens. And again, friends, as we enter this story and hear this, we receive from Christ, but we also find ourselves in the position of those who have been healed. Peter's mother-in-law gets up, and what does she do? She begins to serve Jesus. It's so simple, but it's so beautiful in the lives of God's children. Do I really know what I have received from my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? Am I ready now, given what I have received, whatever it is I have received, to now turn to him and serve him in the ways that he's given me to do that? It's simple, but it's beautiful, and it's powerful in the lives of God's children. Do I expect to be served or to serve? Do I expect to receive, or am I ready to give to God all that I have been given? He heals Peter's mother-in-law. She turns, she begins to serve him. And again, there's a crowd of people there, and so many of them who are sick, he heals. Many who are oppressed by demons, Christ shows his authority over them as well. And then Matthew does this for us. In fact, if you're attentive to it in Matthew's gospel, he does this quite often. Jesus goes over here, and this fulfills what was said in the Old Testament that he would do. Jesus does this, and it fulfills what the Old Testament said he would do. So Matthew tells us, Jesus did all these things to fulfill what the prophet Isaiah spoke about him. He took our illnesses, and he bore our diseases. Isaiah speaks of a Messiah. He speaks of the servant of God who is going to come, who carries the Spirit of God within him and brings the kingdom of God inside of his life and inside of his teaching. And in Isaiah chapter 53, that servant of God is the suffering servant. And it is from that chapter that Matthew grabs this passage. It is, in fact, Matthew's very own translation of the first half of Isaiah chapter 53, verse 4. And when Matthew grabs that half a verse, it's not just half a verse, it's a context. It's an idea. We are still playing with this question, what kind of authority does Jesus have? Authority over leprosy, uncleanliness, the kind of authority the centurion knew that he had, the kind of authority over fever and sickness and even over the demonic realm. But then Matthew says, he does all of this because the Old Testament tells us that Jesus is this kind of person. I'm going to go back to Isaiah chapter 53. In fact, turn your Bibles there with me. Matthew grabs the first part of 53 verse 4. He translates it himself. But this is what we get in the context. This is what Matthew's thinking. Isaiah 53 verse 1. Who has believed what they heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he, servant of God, the Messiah, grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteem him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned away everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Yes, this passage tells us that Christ bears our sicknesses, Christ bears our diseases, and has authority over those kinds of things. But that is true because Jesus Christ has authority over sin itself. It is because Christ, the suffering servant, hung on a cross, resurrected the third day, ascended into heaven, the soon and coming King of Kings can actually forgive sin. That's the kind of authority that just this Jesus has. Friends, Jesus heals. He has the power to heal physically. He has the authority to do even more than that, to make the unclean clean, to restore life that has been lost, to put back together things that have been broken. As Isaiah says, he exchanges ashes for his beauty. Faith in Jesus Christ just is the bottom line of my life. The truth about who he is really matters. Can I stand with the leopard and say, I know if you want to, this can happen? Can I stand with the centurion and say, Lord, I'm not even worthy of you in my presence. Just say the word and it will be done. And friends, Jesus takes away my sin and gives me his life in place of mine. This is the kind of authority that this Jesus really has. Let's pray.